All right. I know you're in your homes, but I want you to put your hands together and thank the Lord for Christine and Nico and Jeff for leading us in worship. And if you want to thank the Lord for Chester and Tim, you can do that as well. What I'd also like to have you do is if you would just show some type of appreciation for the tech team, the media team, who's helping record all these messages and making sure the internet works. We actually had a little glitch, but they worked through all those problems, so we appreciate all the people who are involved with the technology. But aren't you thankful for technology that we can come into your home? And I hope that you're ready today with your sermon notes and your Bible, and hope you had a great time of communion and a great time of worship. As I shared on my Facebook post this last week, we're living in some tough times, but I am extremely optimistic that we're going to get through all this in due season. Things could get worse before they get better, but in due season, I believe that God is going to see us through. It might be 2 weeks, it might be 2 months, it could be a couple of years. We really don't know. But I want to encourage you to continue to try to shelter in your home. Do not go out unless it's absolutely necessary. I believe getting out and doing a little exercise, if you can kind of stay away from folks, that's a good thing. But listen to all the announcements that are coming from our government. And I think this thing is a fluid situation that just continues to change. And there's probably going to be even further changes for us. But just know that I'm praying for you, and I know that you're praying for me. This has been a tough week for our family. As many of you know, last Saturday night, 1 week ago, after church, I drove to Fresno, California to see my ailing father. He's in a nursing home under hospice care. And I got up there about midnight in Fresno, drove across the grapevine. It was kind of raining. I was just thankful there was no snow. And it took me about 30 minutes to get myself inside that nursing home because everything was locked down. And spent the night just with my dad, did not sleep, just spent the whole night. And I prayed over him, I sang hymns to him, I cried over him. And then Sunday evening at 6:38, my dad, this what I call a giant redwood tree spiritually in my life, went on to be with his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we as a family, we rejoice that he is no longer suffering. And I don't say that lightly. I don't know anyone who has suffered as much as he has the last 5-10 years of his life. But we're thankful that he's in his glorified body and that he's actually in the presence of Almighty God. We mourn. I have mourned and I have grieved this week more than I ever have, but I mourn and I grieve with hope. And that's the difference between someone who's saved and someone who's not saved, is that we grieve with hope because I know and believe that I will see my dad once again. And I want to just thank each of you who reached out to me or to my family. It's been impossible for me to get back in touch with everybody, but from my heart to yours, I want to thank you for your prayers and your words of encouragement. And I also want to thank you just for loving my dad. The highlight year after year was when he got up here to this church and you all almost treated him like a rock star. And he talked about that all the time. So I just want to thank you for your prayers. I want to thank you for always loving on him and for just being a blessing to him. On Wednesday of this week, we're going to have a service for him up in Fresno. And because of the virus, no one can go. They've shut it down. Our state is shut down. There'll be a few people there, but we're asking people not to drive up because you really can't go. We want you to stay home and stay safe. And on Thursday of this week, at about 2:00 in the afternoon, we're going to put that service online, so you'll get to see it. I hope you'll watch it, hope you'll share it, as me and my brother will have a little service, just kind of a makeshift service, and we're going to honor my dad in an appropriate way. But again, thank you. for your prayers and for your encouragement. I want to tell you a funny story about my dad. I hope that's okay. I'm going to preach, but I want to tell you a funny story about my dad. And some of you may have heard this story, but we had five children in our house. I've got two older sisters and two younger brothers. And for some reason, Dad always wanted us to call him Papa. We, you know, five kids, were, Dad, can I have this? Dad, can I do this? Dad, he got sick of Dad, hearing Dad. He wanted us to call him Papa. And so what he did, he had this little game that he played with us. He never gave us any allowance. He was too cheap to give us allowance. And so we grew up, you know, roughing it as kids. But Dad had this little game where he would give us 50 cents credit. It wasn't even real money. It was just credit. And what he would do is he would keep track of all five of his kids. Every time we called him Dad, he would deduct a nickel. So, you know, we'd just forget about it. Dad, I only owe you 45 cents. Dad, oh, I only owe you 40 cents. And he kept track of all five kids. And none of us could ever get through a whole week without calling him Dad enough times to not have any money coming to us. Except one week, yours truly, I was the first child of the five. At the end of the week, on Saturday night, I had 35 cents coming to me. All I had to do was go to bed, and in the next morning, I was going to get 35 cents off my tightwad father. So I was so excited. Now, in that day, my brothers and I, we all roomed together in bunk beds. There's so many kids, we didn't have enough bedrooms. Our room was connected to Dad's room. There was actually a door, well, not a hallway. You didn't go out in a hallway. Just a door that went between my dad's bedroom and our bedroom. So we're in bed. Dad had told us to go to sleep, and we kept talking. And all of a sudden, the door flew open, and the light came on, and my dad came into the bedroom. And he said to the boys, he said, "You boys, be quiet. I'm tired of listening to you. It's time to go to bed. I'm not going to tell you again." And he turned the light off, and he shut the door, and he left. Now, for me, that meant to try to be quiet. But I have a brother named Dean who was always in trouble, and Dad's threats never seemed to bother him anymore. My brother Dean keeps talking, and he's talking loud. And I'm trying to get him to be quiet because Dad had just threatened us. And all of a sudden, the door flew open, the light came in, Dad came rushing in. He was really mad. And he goes, "I'm not going to tell you boys this again. Now go to bed." And so he turns the light off, shuts the door, and he leaves. Now, of course, it was Saturday night, so he's all stressed because he's got to get up and preach the next morning. Well, I'm just like shaking in the bed. I'm so scared because I don't want to get a spanking. My brother Dean, he starts singing. He's like, he's trying to get a spanking. And man, all of a sudden, the door flew open, the light came on, my dad came rushing in, and he had a 2x4. I don't even know where he got it, but he had a 2x4, and he came over to me, and he picked me up, and he lifted that board up, almost like, you know, Abraham's sacrifice, but he had a 2x4. He was going to spank me, he was going to hit me with that 2x4, and I went, "Daddy, daddy, 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 daddy." Just like that. And I never got a spanking, and I thought, why is he not spanking me with that board? And I looked up, and he was smiling. He laid the board down. He said, "Son, I don't owe you a dime." And he turned, and he walked out of the room. And so my dad today still owes me 35 cents as far as I'm concerned. Now, I tell you that story to tell you this. This is all true. Many of you know or may have known Coach John Wooden, the basketball coach at UCLA. He won 10 national titles in 12 years. And Coach Wooden attended our church during the latter years of his life. In fact, I actually conducted his funeral. And my dad was here preaching at the church for one of our revivals, and I told the story I just told you. Introducing my dad, and Coach Wooden heard that story. And recently, I was doing a funeral for a woman who had died of cancer, and I asked my assistant if she would go grab all my folders for all the funerals that I've ever done, just to kind of refresh my mind and look up some material and things. And I saw this folder from Coach John Wooden, and I remember I did his funeral. And so Coach used to send me notes, and I put them in that folder, and I just decided to look through that folder. And inside there, I had completely forgotten about this. Coach Wooden, after he heard that story, he had sent me a note. And I want you to see a picture. If you look at the screen, Coach sent me 35 cents. You'll see a quarter, for those of you that are math majors, and two nickels. That's 35 cents. And he wrote me a note. And I want to read this note to you if I can. Look at this note. It says, "Dear Pastor Rutherford, the enclosed check," he had written a check for the revival, "is my sacrificial gift to help defray the cost of the revival meeting, and the 35 cents to help soothe the continuing hurt brought on by the devious methods used to weasel out of a monetary obligation. Love sincerely, Coach John Wooden." Now, I look at that, and it just makes me laugh. Dad, Coach Wooden covered for him that day, but as far as I'm concerned, my dad still owes me 35 cents, and one day when I get to heaven, I'm going to get that 35 cents. Can someone say amen? Hey, I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 8. Grab your sermon notes. We're in a series called Seeing Jesus Clearly, and last weekend, we looked at a sermon called The Fact That Jesus Was Unorthodox, and today, and I've got some good news. I want everybody to smile. I want to speak on the subject that Jesus loves you unconditionally. He loves us unconditionally. And at the end of my sermon, if you're still listening, at the end of my sermon, I'm going to say a word of prayer and a prayer of blessing and a prayer of protection around you and your family. So make sure you stay online until that final prayer. And after the prayer, at the end of the sermon, I have a special blessing, a special surprise for everyone who's listening and watching, and you do not want to miss that special blessing. Again, take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 8. I want to speak to you on the title that God's love, Jesus' love, is unconditional. You know, culturally, as a nation, we've talked about this, we continue to drift further and further away from God. And all kinds of things happen in our culture, and right now we're all fearful of this virus. It's scaring people half to death. It's actually brought our world to a halt. Many of us have never lived through anything like this. And all I want to tell you is that when you go through difficult times, all you need to remember is that Jesus loves you. And he loves you unconditionally. And if you can remember that, you have absolutely nothing to be fearful about as long as you remember that Jesus loves you unconditionally. I want you to turn to someone in the room. There's someone there in the room. Just say them. Say to them, "Jesus loves you unconditionally." Say that. Jesus loves you unconditionally. Now, I want you to say back to that person, the person who just said that to you, you say back to them, "How can you be so sure? How can you be so sure?" Go ahead and say that. And now what I want you to say back to your neighbor is, "Listen to the sermon. Listen to the sermon." I want to give you three reasons why I know that Jesus loves us unconditionally. Number one, write this down if you're taking notes. First of all, what's called the declaration of the scriptures. The declaration of the scriptures. And as you read through the Bible, page after page after page after page after page after page is the story of how God loves you and how God loves me unconditionally. And the first reason why I know this is true is simply because the Bible declares that he loves us. And I just want to read through some of these verses. Romans chapter 8, verse 38, it says, "For I am convinced," I want everybody to say the word convinced, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else, including COVID-19, anything else in all creation, that nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. Ephesians 3 verse 19 tells us that God's love surpasses knowledge. 1 John chapter 4 verse 7 and 8, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. 1 John 4 verse 19 tells us we love because he first loved us. In John chapter 15 verse 9, the Bible says, as the Father has loved me, Jesus said, so have I loved you. And then in John chapter 15 verse 12, Jesus said these words, my command is this, to love each other as I, Jesus, have loved you. Now, what I want to ask you is, what am I reading out of right here? Am I reading out of an encyclopedia? Am I reading out of Reader's Digest? Am I reading out of the Los Angeles Times? What am I reading out of? I'm reading out of the Bible, the B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. You can tell I have two grandchildren. You can, because I sing that song to them all the time. Now, this book, the Bible, is either true or it's not true. If it's not true, if the Bible is not true, I say we close it up. And we just go about our business, because there is no God and there is no truth and there is no such thing as God's word. But if it is true, if this book is true, and I believe it is true, then you can be assured that Jesus loves you and Jesus loves me because the Bible declares it. I want us to sing this song. We're going to actually sing this together. Now, I'm not much of a singer, and maybe you're not, but whoever's listening, whoever's in your house, in your home, we're going to sing this little chorus together. It's called Jesus Loves Me This I Know. I want you to sing it with me. Don't be bashful. Don't be shame, afraid. We're going to sing Jesus Loves Me. Are you ready? Here we go. Here we go. We're going together. Jesus loves me. Yes, I know. For the Bible tells me so, little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. How do you know? How do you know? The Bible tells me so. Amen, amen. I want to tell you one of my favorite stories of Dwight L. Moody. Dwight L. Moody was an evangelist from Chicago, and he's the only man that was ever said that he shook two continents for God. He shook the United States, and he shook Europe. This was back in the day before you had modern transportation, where it took you months to go back and forth on a ship. Dwight L. Moody, the only man who ever said that he shook two continents for God. And one day, Dwight L. Moody was over in Europe, and he was speaking, and this little short evangelist, a little man, came up to him by the name of Henry Morehouse. And Henry Morehouse just kind of introduced himself. He said, Mr. Moody, my name is Henry Morehouse. And he goes, one day I'm going to come to America, and when I come to America, I'm going to be willing to preach for you. Well, Dwight L. Moody kind of forgot about it. He didn't think much about it, and several months went by. Dwight L. Moody was back in America. He was back at his church in Chicago, and he received a telegram. Now, all of you young people that don't know what a telegram is, just ask your parents. They'll explain what a telegram is. It's kind of like a text message. But Dwight L. Moody's at his church, and he gets a telegram, and it's from Henry Morehouse, and here's what it says. It says, Dear Mr. Moody, my name is Henry Morehouse. Several months ago, I met you in Europe. I want you to know that I'm coming to the United States. I will be there today. And if you need me to preach for you, I am willing to fill in at your pulpit. Well, it just so happened that Wednesday night at Bible study that Dwight L. Moody had to be out of town, and he did not have a speaker lined up to speak. And so he gathered his elders together, and he told his leadership, he said, look, many months ago, I was over in Europe. I met this guy named Henry Morehouse, and he's here in America. I'm going to let him preach tonight at our church. He said to his men, I want you there, though, in case he starts to say something that he shouldn't say. I want you elders to stand up and take over the service, because I've never really heard the guy preach. Well, they all agreed. Dwight L. Moody left town. The elders were there that night. Henry Morehouse was there. They introduced him. And Henry Morehouse, he stepped into the pulpit of the great Dwight L. Moody. And here's what he said. He said, ladies and gentlemen, take your Bible and turn to John chapter 3, verse 16. He preached what those people said was the greatest sermon that they'd ever heard in their life on the text of John 3, 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. At the end of his sermon, here's what Henry Morehouse said. He said, anyone in this room that wants to make a decision for Jesus Christ, stay right where you are. The rest of you are dismissed. And the story goes, not a single person got up and walked out of that room that night. That every single person made a decision for Jesus Christ that night after hearing that sermon on the love of God. The elders got together in the back of the room and they said to Henry Morehouse, hey, what are you doing tomorrow night? He said, Thursday night. He said, what are you doing? He said, I'm not doing anything. They said, would you be willing to come back and preach for us tomorrow night? He said, I'd love to. So before they dismissed, the elders stood up and they said, ladies and gentlemen, come back tomorrow night, Thursday night. Henry Morehouse will be preaching again. The next night, Thursday night, the house was packed. And for the second night in a row, Henry Morehouse stood into the pulpit of the great Dwight L. Moody, and here's what he said. Ladies and gentlemen, take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. And again, he preached one of the greatest sermons that they had ever heard in their life. The elders got together in the back of the room. They said, what are you doing tomorrow night? He said, nothing. They stood up. They said, hey, people, come back tomorrow night. It's Friday night. Henry Morehouse is going to preach again. Friday night came, Henry Morehouse stepped back in the pulpit. His text again was John chapter 3, verse 16. It was so good, the elder said, what are you doing tomorrow night? He said, Saturday night, I'm not doing anything. They stood up, they announced, hey, come back tomorrow night, Saturday night. Henry Morehouse will preach. Now, guess who came back in town Saturday afternoon? It was Dwight L. Moody, and his wife met him. And he said, how are things going? And she said, great, we're having a revival down at the church. He said, revival? What do you mean we're having a revival? She said, you know that guy that you invited to speak on Wednesday night? Dwight L. Moody said, I didn't invite him, he invited himself. She said, you know who I'm talking about. Said, he did such a good job Wednesday night, the elders asked him to come back Thursday night. He did such a good job Thursday night, they asked him to come back Friday night. He did such a good job on Friday night, they invited him to speak tonight, Saturday night. He's speaking tonight at your church. She said to Dwight L. Moody, you should go down there yourself. She said, who knows? Maybe you'll get converted. Well, Dwight L. Moody went to church that night. He says that he sat on the front row with a very skeptical spirit. As he watched and as he listened and as he heard, on Saturday night, Henry Morehouse stepped into his pulpit at that great church in Chicago. And here's what he said, ladies and gentlemen, take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 3, verse 16. I want to speak to you a message on the love of God. And they said that he preached one of the greatest sermons that have ever been preached. And Dwight L. Moody said that it was the greatest sermon that he'd ever heard. Now historians who've studied the life and the ministry of Dwight L. Moody tell us this, that up to this point in his life, he had always preached on the judgment of Christ. But after that night, hearing the message from Henry Morehouse, that his ministry shifted. And from that point forward, the great evangelist Henry Morehouse began to preach on the love of Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, what I want you to know is that that revival lasted for 6 weeks. And every night for 6 weeks, the text was John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Let there be no misunderstanding that Jesus loves you unconditionally. The Bible declares it. Every book, every chapter, every page, every verse, every line, every word screams and declares that Jesus Christ loves you, and he loves you unconditionally. And all God's people said, amen. And amen. Let's go to point two. How do we know he loves us unconditionally? Well, we see this in the scriptures. Write this down. His devotion to the sinners, to the way he dealt with people that were engaged or involved with sin, his devotion to the sinner. I want to do something. This is a fun little exercise. You can do this right in your house. I want you to turn over to Mark chapter 2, and we'll put the verses on the screen. Mark chapter 2, I want to read and spend some time in this text here in Mark chapter 2, and you're going to see the word sinner, and you're going to see the word tax collector over and over again. So right there in your house, or if you're watching on TV, or on your iPad or on your phone, as I read through the text, every time I say the word sinner, I want you just to hold your nose and go like this, okay? Okay, just do that, all right? Stinky. Sinners are stinky, okay? And when I say tax collector, I want you to put your thumb down and just go boo, all right? Let's practice, all right? We're gonna practice. When you hear the word sinner, everybody do this. Good, good, good. And when I say tax collector, you do this. Just go boo. Good, 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 good. All right. I feel like you're really enjoying that way too much. But let me read through the text. I'll help you along. Mark chapter 2, verse 13, we're looking at Jesus' devotion to the sinners. Verse 13, once again, Jesus went out beside a lake, and a large crowd came to him, and he began to what? To teach them. Verse 14, as he walked along, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, Jesus told him, and Levi got up and follow Jesus. Verse 15, while Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, the Bible says that there were many tax collectors, and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. Verse 16, this is Mark chapter 2, verse 16. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and the tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you read this Bible cover to cover, it is made up of stories just like this story of Jesus meeting with tax collectors and sinners in Mark chapter 2. You'll read stories about people that are lost or broken or disillusioned, and God, in his love, reaches out to them. Over and over again, we talked last week about the shepherd who had 100 sheep and one went astray, one went astray. The shepherd went and found that one lost sheep. It's the picture of the love of God. There's a story in the Bible of a woman named Rahab who was a harlot, yet God saved her because that's the type of people God saves. There's a story about a leper who is sick, and Jesus reaches out and touches and heals someone with a disease because that's the type of man he was, the type of savior he was. There's a book in the Bible called Hosea. It's about a man who marries a woman named Gomer. And Gomer is a woman of the night. And so the prophet Hosea, God said, go marry Hosea, go marry Gomer. And so he goes out and he marries this woman of the night. And he redeems her and he restores her and takes care of her. And what does she do to show her appreciation? She turns and she goes right back out into a life of sin. She left Hosea, And God, and Hosea said, what do you want me to do now, God? God said, Hosea, I want you to go get her again. Go redeem her again. Why would God say that? Because that's the type of God we serve. He wants to give you a second chance and a third chance and a fourth chance. There's a man named Peter who asked Jesus, how many times am I supposed to forgive people? Seven times? Jesus said not seven times, but 70 times seven. You're to just keep forgiving people the way I have forgiven you. We remember that Jesus turned to the thief, a guy on the cross as Jesus was dying. One of his last words was to a thief who had done nothing but rob and steal from people his entire life, yet Jesus showed mercy. Jesus showed compassion. He told the thief, today you will be with me in paradise. All of these stories illustrate how much God is devoted to reaching lost sinners. Today, if you just looked at the people in the room where you're seated there, I mean, just take a look at who's here. We had close to 20,000 people watching the sermon last week. Now think about that, 20,000 people. You know, these people have, many of them, their lives are messed up. They have drifted away from God. The Bible says that we've all sinned. The Bible says that we've all fallen short. We've all made mistakes. We've all sinned. We all have transgressions. We all have a past. And yet, even though we have a bad past, even though we have skeletons in the closet, even though we've made many mistakes, Jesus loves us unconditionally. His desire, his intent, now hear me, that no matter how flawed we are, no matter how great our addictions may be, no matter how far we have drifted away from God, no matter how deep into sin we are, his desire, his intent is to redeem us, to restore us, to forgive us, and to love us. Many times we in the church, we like to trample on the fallen. Jesus likes to restore the fallen. And if you're listening here today, I just want you to know that if you're broken, or if you're discouraged, or you're downhearted, or you're fearful, if you feel unloved, if you feel unwelcomed, if you feel unfixable, you need to come to Jesus. Because there is nothing in your life that you could ever do that would cause God to love you any more than he already loves you. And there is nothing you could ever do to ever cause God to love you any less than what he already does. He loves you unconditionally. I want you to go back and look at verse 15, Mark chapter 2. There's a couple more verses. Look at verse 15. We read this once already, but there's one word in verse 15 that's in there two times. And it's the word many. Look at verse 15. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, the Bible says there weren't just a few tax collectors and sinners. The Bible says there were many tax collectors and many sinners that were eating with him and his disciples. For there were, here it is for the second time, there were many who followed him. Jesus wasn't some weird, creepy guy that no one wanted to be around. No, he was so unique, so kind, he was so engaging, he was so sincere, so loving, so genuinely concerned about others that many people were drawn to him. There were many tax collectors and many sinners that just wanted to be around Jesus. Jesus didn't care how wealthy they were. He didn't care what color their skin was. He didn't care what their social status was. He didn't care if they were a saint or a sinner. He didn't even care if they were in the church or out of the church. He loved tax collectors. He loved sinners. He loved lost people. He loves you and he loves me. That's what you need to know and understand that the Bible talks about that. I've read through the Gospel of John. I don't know if you've ever just read through one of the Gospels and just look at all the people that Jesus hung out with. In John chapter 1, he's with some fishermen, some stinking, smelling, uneducated, dirty, foul-mouthed fishermen. That's who he's hanging out with in John chapter 1. John chapter 2, he's at a wedding. You know what happens at a wedding. You know what kind of crowd gathers at a wedding. And Jesus was one that turned the water into the wine in John chapter 2. John chapter 3, he's with a Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus. John chapter 4, He's with a Samaritan woman that has been married and divorced five times. She got married and divorced, married and divorced, married and divorced, married and divorced, married and divorced. And finally, she's just living, this guy number six, she's just living with guy number six. And yet Jesus spent time with her and tried to reach her and lead her into a saving relationship with his heavenly Father. John chapter 5, he's at a feast called the Feast of the Jews in Jerusalem. And the Jews were the one, of course, that ended up rejecting him. In John chapter 6, he feeds 5,000, he's at a picnic, and he feeds Jesus. He feeds 5,000 people. You know there were some good people and there were some bad people in that crowd. He fed all 5,000 of them, and he himself picked up the tab. John chapter 7, he stands once again before the scribes and the Pharisees. In John chapter 8, he's with a woman that was caught in the act of adultery. On and on it goes, the devotion that Jesus showed to lost sinners. Now look at verse 17. This is one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. Verse 17, it says, on hearing this, on hearing what? Well, the question that was up there in verse 16, where the disciples asked, why does he eat with tax collectors and why does he eat with sinners? Jesus said this, verse 17, on hearing this, Jesus said to them, he said, now this, he didn't really say, but I think he said, you knuckleheads is what he said. You knuckleheads, here's what he said. It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. He said, I've not come to call the righteous, I've come to call sinners. It's why he came to this earth in the first place, not for people who are righteous. He came for unrighteous people. Can you imagine a doctor who says, I only see healthy patients, that's all I see, you're sick, oh, I can't see you, I only see healthy patients. Can you imagine a dentist who says, I only see people with perfect teeth? Well, that doesn't even make any sense. Can you imagine a firefighter who says, I only go to houses that are not burning? Doesn't make sense. Jesus is called Savior. And the reason he's called Savior is because he goes out and he seeks and he searches and he saves lost people. It's why he came. And I just want you to know, so should we. We should have the same passion and the same zeal to love people unconditionally. Can someone say amen to that? It is so sad to me. I look around. Now listen, I'm like you. I look around. I see so many people right now that are living in fear. And this is our moment. It's the church's moment to show people faith and to point people to Jesus, because Jesus came to save. All I hear are people complaining. I hear people worried. I hear people that are upset. And what we need to do is to serve and to love and to pray and to be the hands and feet of Jesus to this city and to this world that is hopelessly lost during this moment. You know, the average church, now if you come to Shepherd, you're not a part of an average church. The average church, the normal church in America, has less than one convert per year. Less than one convert per year. Now, here's what that means. Here at Shepherd, we'll have 1,000 people that are baptized just about every year. We have 1,000 people. Now, if we have 1,000 baptisms, that means that there are 1,000 churches that don't have a single convert, not a single convert. Think about that. If we have 1,000, that means there's 1,000 churches that don't have a single convert. If the average is less than one convert per congregation, I want you to write this down in your notes. The church is the only business that can go out of business and stay in business. I want to say that to you again. The church is the only business that can go out of business and stay in business. Listen, the goal, the great commission for the church is to take the gospel to every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl. I want to tell you again, when the church stops showing compassion and mercy for the lost, then it quits being the church. When the church stops loving and reaching out
to the unsaved, then it ceases being a church. When the church only cares about saved people, then it stops being a church and it becomes nothing but a social club. Listen, don't ever say to me, it's so hard for me to be a Christian where I live. It's so hard for me to be a Christian where I work. It's so hard for me to be a Christian at my school or around my friends. Brother, that's exactly where you're supposed to be. Has it ever dawned on you that God in heaven picked you? He selected you. He chose you to be a witness, to be a testimony to his grace, to his love, and to his mercy to every single person you come in contact with. And all God's people said, amen and amen. So three reasons why I know he loves me unconditionally. Number one is the declaration of the scriptures. Number two, when I read Jesus's devotion to sinners, but here's number three, and I'm wrapping this sermon up here in just a moment. John chapter, this point is the death of the Savior. When you think about the death of the Savior, when you think about what Jesus did on that cross for you and for me, you can't help but know that he loves us unconditionally. John chapter 15, verse 13 says, there's greater love has no one than this, that he that laid down his life for his what? For his friends. Read that verse again, John 15, 13. Greater love has no one than this, than he that laid down his life for his friends. And I suppose, you know, that's true. I think there's some husbands watching right now. There are some who would be willing to lay down their life for their wife. Amen. I think there's some mothers and there's some women listening right now. You would be willing to lay down your life for your children if need be. Oh, and there might even be some siblings out here who would be willing to lay down your life for your fellow sibling. Not me, but maybe you. Oh, listen to me. The Bible says greater love has no one than this, than someone who would lay down his life for his friends. You know, it's like a friend. Now look at Romans 5, verse 7. It says, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But look at Romans 5, verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, not his friend, while we were still sinners, that Christ died for us. Christ died for us. Ladies and gentlemen, all you've got to do is look at the cross and know that when Jesus went to that cross, he was beaten, he was stripped, he was mocked, his beard was plucked, they spit in his face again and again. The Bible says they beat his face so bad, not that his face no longer looked like a man, it says that he no longer even looked like a human being. He was beat that bad. And then he goes to the cross and he drives those nails. They drove those nails through his hands and through his feet. They put a crown of thorns upon his brow. They thrust that spear into his side. And when Jesus died on that cross, you have to see that when he died on that cross, that he died for you. Christ died for us. He died for you. In other words, we should have had to have died. We should have had to be nailed to that cross because we were the ones that committed the sin. But God loved us so much that he was willing to give up his one and only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but shall have everlasting life. My last story, and then we're going to close. I'm going to pray. I want you to look at this picture. This is a mom and a dad, Gary and Mary Jane, and they have a girl named Andrea, and Andrea was 11 years old. This is in the newspaper. I actually was reading the newspaper and found this article myself. Andrea, this 11-year-old girl, she had cerebral palsy. Now, they say that she was a straight-A student, and they say that she was a bright student that everybody loved her, but she had cerebral palsy. She couldn't walk. She was bound to a wheelchair. And this is a true story that happened several years ago. Her mom and her dad decided they wanted to put her on a train. so that she could experience what it's like, you know, to move. And they put her on a train that went across the southern states. It went across what's called the Alabama Bayou. And as that train, the mom and dad and that girl, they were on that train and they were going down the railroad tracks. There was a bridge or an accident of some sort. And there was a train wreck. And at the time, it was the largest ever train crash in the history of Amtrak at the time. And the railroad car that had this little girl, then mom and dad, it went off the track and it turned sideways, and the railroad car was completely submerged underneath the murky Alabama Bayou water. That train car was submerged on its side and underneath the water. Now, if you read this article, and I have it here in my notes, the mom and dad perished in that train accident. But that little girl, Andrea, lived. Now, how did she live? She couldn't even walk. She's in a wheelchair. They had her on that train just to experience what it was like to be on a train. Well, when that train, that railroad car, fell off the railroad track and turned sideways and submerged, there was a window that was open. And somebody, they don't know who, somebody lifted that little girl up out of that window. The car is submerged, but someone inside that railroad car was lifting that little girl up out of that window. And as she was up out of that window, someone saw her and reached down and rescued her. And in this article, Andrea, they asked her what happened. And Andrea said, I don't know what happened. She said, someone lifted me out of that window. She said this. She says, I don't know who it was, but I think it was my mom and my dad. And when I read that article, I wanted to say, Andrea, Andrea, Andrea. It's not that I think. I know it was your mom and dad that lifted you out of that window. Because I know they loved you the same way I love my children. We would do anything. And in that same way, you and I, in a sense, all of us are on a railroad car headed to destruction. Our sin is what leads us down this path of destruction. And we find ourselves in a hopeless and a helpless situation. And yet God, in his great love and in his great mercy, when we didn't deserve it and there was nothing we could do of our own free volition to save ourselves, someone lifted us up out of that miry clay. It was the Lord Jesus Christ who died on that cross so that you and I could have everlasting life. Amen, amen, and amen. The declaration of the scriptures, his devotion to the sinners, and the death of the Savior. I know that Jesus loves you and he loves me unconditionally. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to close this service up. If you're listening today and you have in your heart, you want to make a decision, and I would tell you with everything that's going on in this world, if you don't know for sure, if you are watching and you don't know for sure that you're saved, you need to talk to someone in that house with you right now, or you can text us the word Jesus to the number that's on the screen. You just get your phone out and you look up that number, maybe you scribble it down right now, and you just text the word Jesus. Just text Jesus, and we'll get a hold of you. And we will talk to you about your decision, and we'll find a way to baptize you. We'll have a pastor get a hold of you. And if you just have a prayer request, again, you can text us. We have people that are willing and waiting to pray for you right now. God, thank you for every house, for every listener, whether they're watching online, whether they're watching on Facebook or on television or listening on the radio or on the internet. God, we thank you that during this difficult time in our world that we can still have this technology where we can still worship and we can still participate in the Lord's Supper and we can still be the church. But Lord, we have so many people that are living without hope. And I just want every listener to know that Jesus, the Christ, the Son of the living God, loves us unconditionally. The Bible declares it. We see it by Jesus' example. And ultimately, he goes to the cross and he dies just so we can have everlasting life. And if anyone, again, is listening that they do not know Jesus or they do not have a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, oh, Lord God, help them today to put their faith and their trust in you and in you alone, oh, God. Bless every listener. And as Nico comes to sing, God, I just pray that we would listen to these words and know that Jesus Christ came to give us hope as he gave hope to that adulterous woman, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.